name is Meshack Kodiko, a teacher of biology. Welcome to our today's lesson, where we're going to talk about food tests. Food test is one of the parts of the biology practical where we do a lot of mistakes. So when you are given different samples that you can be given, during maybe preparation of samples, you can be given some reagents, and we know that each and every reagent that is used for particular food substances to be tested. So for example, you can be given some samples to mix in certain proportions so that you obtain solutions. And these solutions could be named as solution X, solution W, Q, and whichever letter that is used. So when we are given that, we are only supposed to use the solution that we have been provided with. Even if you know that the substance that has been provided, for example, is milk, don't talk about milk because you are not given milk. We are finding out what solution is there and what food substances are present in that solution. So let us not talk about things like put milk in a test tube. We are not providing the milk, so you use the solution that you've been given. So sometimes you can be given, look at the table that you've been given. If the first column here is written test, then you are not supposed to write, you talk about starch test, protein test. Protein test is also called burette test. The reducing sugar test, the non-reducing sugar test, the lipid test, something like that. So if you are given food, then you're supposed to name that food substance. For example, assuming that we have been given solution X, so we want test for starch. How do we test for starch? We always make mistakes. When you are given that, you are told you put two cubic centimeters of solution X in a test tube. Then after putting that cubic centimeters, you add two drops of iodine solution. This is where we also make a mistake. We don't talk about add iodine. We have iodine solid, so we don't need to talk about add iodine. We add iodine solution and then you shake. Sometimes you can do this properly, but when it comes to observation, you fail to observe correctly. When you see the solution changes to a blue black color, you just need to talk about, give us the observation, blue black color observed. If a blue black color is observed, then your conclusion would be starch present. Don't just say starch, talk about starch present. But again, it is always not obvious that it will always appear. So sometimes the brown color of iodine solution may persist or remain. If the brown color of iodine solution persists or remains, then our conclusion would be starch absent. Remember, if the procedure is wrong, you are going to make a wrong observation and therefore you cannot get a mark for conclusion. So the three parts must all be correct. Test for protein. What do? Place 2 cubic centimeters of the same solution that you have been given, solution X, in a test tube. Then add 2 cubic centimeters of sodium hydroxide, but I would always advocate that when you're using this, then we write them in full. Because should you fail to write the correct symbols, or maybe chemical formula, then we'll underline that part and then you'll not get a mark for it. So sodium hydroxide followed by equal amount of copper 2 sulfate. So only indicate the percentages if they have been indicated in the reagents that have been provided. For example, if you are given, let's say, 10% sodium hydroxide and 1% copper sulfate. If they are not indicated, then don't bother yourself indicating those percentages. So put 2 cubic centimeters of solution X in a test tube, add 2 cubic centimeters of sodium hydroxide followed by equal amount. When I talk about equal amount, then I'm referring to the amount that you had added of what? Sodium hydroxide. Then what will happen? Purple color observed. Many a times students talk about violet color. Can we should avoid at all cost talking about violet color. So it is purple color observed. When the purple color is observed, then we conclude that proteins are present. But if the blue color of copper sulfate, remember it is the copper sulfate that we added later. So if the blue color of the copper sulfate persists or remains, our conclusion becomes proteins absent. Now, when we are talking about reducing sugar, when we talk about reducing sugars, now you put 2 cubic centimeters of solution X in a test tube. Add equal amount of Benedict. Look at this. I have underlined the letter B. It must be a capital B. This capital B is important because Benedict is named after the person who discovered the reagent. So we talk about capital B plus this apostrophe must always be indicated. So you add equal amount. This equal amount is in reference to the amount that you had put in a test tube or rather a boiling tube. A Benedict solution and heat to boil. Look at this again. Sometimes we reach to unheat. But should you be given a water bath, then we talk about heat on a water bath. In a water bath, it is sometimes very difficult for it to boil. So if you are given a Bunsen burner, then talk about heat to boil because Bunsen burner will make it boil. But a water bath, just heat it on a water bath. Then, if you do not know the color sequence, because you have to be very keen at this particular time, when we are doing this, you realize that orange color is observed. That is the final color. But if you do know, you know the color sequence, you'll find that it will change from blue to green to yellow and finally to orange. If you know that color sequence, then put it there. But if you don't want to bother yourself with so many colors that may confuse you, you cannot talk about blue, green, yellow, and then to orange. This is the color sequence. If you are very keen, the first color is Benedict solution is blue, changing to green, then from there it changes to yellow, and then to orange. So if you are not sure of the color sequence, then give us the final color. We sometimes, some of us see orange as red, some of we see at as yellow. So if orange color is observed, then reducing sugar present. Please don't abbreviate. Just write reducing sugar present. But if the blue color of Benedict solution persists, then reducing sugar absent. When we come to non-reducing sugar, non-reducing sugar is the one that is having the highest, or maybe the longest procedure. Place 2 cubic centimeters in a test tube, add 2 drops of dilute hydrochloric acid and heat. That's the first thing. Heating with this one is going to hydrolyze the food substance. And then you cool it. After cooling, add sodium hydroxide, sodium hydrogen carbonate, dropwise. You can talk about dropwise or drop by drop until fizzing stops. That is, by the time you are going to add it there, drop by drop until you realize that that fizzing sound that is produced stops. Then after that, you add equal volume of Benedict solution and heat to boil. The same color sequence, if at all non-reducing sugar is present, would be there. Blue color changes to green to yellow and finally to orange. But if you do not know that sequence again, we are going to talk about the orange color. Now, therefore, non-reducing sugar present. But if the blue color persists, then we talk about non-reducing sugar absent. When we come to lipids here, you'll be provided with a filter paper. So you are supposed to smear a small sample of solution X on the surface of the filter paper. Then this aspect of drying, don't say hold it over a flame, taking care not to burn it. Many a time students talk about that. But we want the aspect of drying.
dry it over a flame. After you dry it over a flame, you are going to realize that if the lipids or fats are present, then there is going to be formation of a permanent translucent mark appears on the surface of the paper. Then you conclude lipids present. But if no permanent translucent mark appears on the surface of the paper, then our conclusion would be lipids absent. So maybe the last thing that you want to talk about is vitamin C, which has got an opposite procedure, where you now don't put this food, the food substance, but then we put the reagent, which is DCPID. That is dichlorophenol indophenol indicator. So you put 2 cubic centimeters of DCPIP on there in the test tube, then add drop by drop solution X. Our observation would be that the blue color of DCPIP will be decolorized. Decolorized. Conclusion, vitamin C present. So if we talk about, it is not discolorized, it is decolorized. But if the blue color of DCPIP is not decolorized, then our conclusion is vitamin C absent. So that was our today's lesson, and I want to thank you for listening to our lesson of today.